Good morning and a warm welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is declaration of interest as a result of membership change. I want to put on record again my thanks to Ben McPherson, Alistair Allen and Maurice Golden for their commitment to the committee and wish them well in their new roles. And also a warm welcome to Kate Forbes, Keith Brown and Alexander Stewart to join the committee. And I'd like to invite you each to make any relevant declaration of interest. And Kate, could I start with you?
I don't believe I have any relevant interest to declare.
Thank you. Alexander?
I have none other, but I'm delighted to return to this committee. I sat on for 3 years in the past session, so look forward to it convening. Oh,
thank you very much. And Keith?
I'm not aware of any direct interest, although I should, in the interest of transparency, say that my partner is the Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development.
Thank you very much. So our second agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Can we take agenda item 4 in private? Thank you very much. And our next agenda item, can I just point out that we're joined in a hybrid meeting. Our Deputy Convener, Don Cameron, is joining us remotely. So hopefully we'll be able to manage questions and interactions on that basis. Thank you once again to the Office of the Internal Market. We have Murdo McLennan, Chair of the Office of the Internal Market, and Rachel Merrilee, Senior Director of the Office of the Internal Market, and a warm welcome to committee. I wonder if I could open questions My apologies. Can we have an opening statement from you?
Right. Good morning, Convener. Deputy Convener and committee members. For those that don't know me, I'm the panel chair, Murdoch McLennan, panel chair of the OIM. Rachel Merrilee is the senior director of the Office of the Internal Market. And Rachel and I really welcome the opportunity to meet with you this morning and to update the committee on the recent work of the OIM. And with the committee's permission, I just want to briefly set out some key points. It's only a couple of minutes, but it's a helpful background. As the committee is aware, the OIM launched in September 2021. Our role is to assist governments, legislatures and other key stakeholders across the UK in understanding how effectively business can trade their products and services across the four nations and the impact of the regulatory provisions in this. Our advice and reports are non-binding. The OIM is not the regulator of the internal market, and unlike other parts of the CMA, we have no enforcement role here at all. The OIM also works even-handedly in relation to all four governments. It's also worth mentioning that the Northern Ireland Protocol matters are really outside our scope of the functions under the UKIM Act. And since our last evidence session before this committee, which was in January 2022, the OIM has achieved several milestones. We published our first monitoring reports on the operation of the UK internal market and the effectiveness of the UK internal market regime. The reports are the first of their kind on the UK internal market. We've also published our intra-UK trade data strategy roadmap, which looks to promote the collection and publication of intra-UK trade data, which is, I'll come back to this again and again in the meeting if I may, because we're trying to build up as strong a database as we possibly can to make, not our job easier, but to make it more relevant to the governments. We continue to have excellent engagement with businesses and other stakeholders in Scotland, including Scottish Government officials. And just to register, Convener, if I may, our sincere gratitude to the amount of work that they put into that too. They've been very, very helpful. The OIM has developed open, equal working relationships across the four nations, and we welcome our ongoing engagement with and the invitation from this committee to appear today. I hope that's helpful as a sort of intro. And we're very happy to answer any questions, and then I'll be coming back asking for some help and support, if I may.
Oh, thank you very much. That was indeed helpful, and I'm sure sets the scene for our deliberations today. I wonder if I could open with a question that has been an area of concern raised by this committee as a scrutiny committee of the Scottish Parliament in terms of the transparency around the common frameworks, as they tend to be done at officer-to-officer level. It's difficult to actually scrutinise the development of common frameworks and to understand exactly what negotiations have taken place. So we'd be interested to know if you're aware of these concerns, which I know are shared across some of the other legislatures, and to understand, I believe that you issue a questionnaire asking about whether exclusions from the market access principles have been requested or granted. And I was wondering if there was an intention to publish that data to make it available to the parliaments.
Shall I pick that one up? Thank you very much, and I also welcome the opportunity to be in front of the committee today. I mean, common frameworks, first of all, to take a step back, I suppose, we kind of recognise that they're a really important way in which regulatory divergence or indeed regulatory alignment between the four nations can be managed. But we're very open to supporting the process as far as our statutory duties allow. I think in our periodic report, we flagged up the question of transparency, as you rightly say. We found when we were gathering evidence at our round tables that a lot of people were not aware, particularly on the business and trade association side, people were not necessarily aware of the common frameworks. And where they were, they didn't really have a lot of information about what those common frameworks, what the discussions were about, and what the key issues were that were under consideration. So we'd certainly support your suggestion that there should be greater transparency. Obviously, it's not for us. It's not our process. That's something for the governments to think about. But we certainly support the idea that there should be greater transparency. Transparency is something that's really important in our work in general. I mean, there's always a trade-off between transparency and confidentiality that needs to be taken seriously. And as the CMA, we're very used to kind of that, carrying out that balancing act. But our default is to be transparent. It's something that we feel strongly about because we think that way we get the best inputs and we get the best evidence, which, as Murdoch said, is something that's really important to us.
And in terms of the publication of some of that data, is it an indication that you might actually publish the requests or some data around the number of requests? Or?
You're talking about exclusion requests here.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. I mean, that's not really for us to do. The exclusion requests are things that come through the common frameworks process and are managed by the governments. Obviously, when we do our periodic, our statutory reporting, we're interested to understand how well common frameworks are working. And as you've seen in our last report, we have published the information that we've gathered across the four governments and also, as I say, from a range of different stakeholders about how that's happening.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll move to questions from the committee. And I can invite first Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. The report repeatedly mentions issues with businesses not understanding or appreciating that regulatory divergence could occur across the UK. Is there or could there be more work done to educate businesses and those likely to be affected on that possibility?
That's a very good point. Certainly more can be done. I think if you're in business, you don't really worry about anything. If you're trading effectively across the four nations, then why? There's no problem. So don't get concerned. But for the future, yes, it's important they understand. I think the trade associations and the contact we've had with them has been very effective. They get it, and some of the larger companies get it. But basically, at the moment, it's very early days for the OIM. But As they don't have any problems really trading across the four nations, they don't show a great deal of interest in that particular point. As time moves on, it's a certainty. And And that's one of the things we'd appreciate your maybe help and guidance about how to get in contact with the business world on a broader base. We have plenty of engagement at the moment, but it's never enough. Data collecting is the probably one of the most important aspects of that at the moment, and we're working on it.
Thanks, and thanks for the work we are doing on it. And I know what you've said about the engagement you are carrying out with Scottish business. Do you think, are you concerned though, after 3 years of the UK Internal Market Act being in operation, that there is still a lack of understanding?
Well, back to the bit, if you're in business, you're too busy trying to trade effectively. Part of our job is to make sure that companies across the four nations can trade effectively, unencumbered, for the benefit not just of their businesses, but for the benefit of consumers, and to keep competition going. But it's just early days. It's not a problem at the moment.
So you think the primary reason is companies have been operating on the basis of a single market across the EU, and they're assuming that, you know, the UK internal market is operating with the same standards across the UK. Do you think that's the kind of primary reason why there's a lack of understanding about it? It's just that assumption.
It's not so much the assumption. It's just the basic trading. If you don't have any barriers to trade, then you're not bothered. That's it.
Okay.
Maybe I can just interject for a moment, because of course we gathered quite a lot of evidence from businesses as part of our statutory reporting. And I mean, as Murdoch says, the vast majority have no issues trading across the UK. I think we said something like 15% trade across the UK, across the nations, and then of those, only less than 10% flagged up issues with differing regulations. So I think Murdoch's absolutely right that for the vast majority, they can trade seamlessly. A lot of businesses, I don't think, even think about the fact that they're trading cross border. They have no particular reason to do so. And so I think it's something that will become, you know, more evident as time goes on. And obviously, there hasn't been a huge amount of regulatory divergence either since, post-transition. But as that builds, if it does, then that is something that they will need to be more aware of.
Thank you.
Okay, can I bring in Alexander?
Can I just have a supplementary, Mr. Bibby? You've talked about data, and I think data is vitally important here. Trade associations and federations may collect that for their own sectors. How well do you manage with that? Because, as I say, some sectors are very proactive in ensuring that they have the data for their own sector, but others do not seem to have that robustness, and it's trying to manage that so that there's a much better understanding, because even as you identify in different parts of the country, some federations and organisations are much more robust at putting that together.
Yeah, so we use the data and volumes of intra-UK trade as a priority indicator of basically, you're right, assessing the effectiveness of the market. Again, it's early days. We put this as a major priority for us, because that will improve our effectiveness. We're there as a resource for you, for businesses, for other stakeholders, and that's the way we see ourselves operating, very much on an even-handedness basis across the four nations.
Can I bring in Mr. Cameron? Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Also a question on data, and I'm very sorry not to be there in person. Should I preface my question with that? I was very interested in your experience of finding data on intra-UK trade. And in your report, I think you say that the available data on intra-UK trade was limited, with long lags before figures were available for Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and no data at all for England. And I think you also mentioned inconsistencies in the way data is collected. So I wondered what governments can do to improve that, or how anyone really, including businesses, can do to improve that. And a more specific question about the data strategy roadmap. and the Scottish Government's commitment to publishing single export statistics, Scotland, and whether we need more regular statistics on exports for Scotland than that which is currently promised. Thank you.
Yes, I'm happy to pick that one up. I mean, as Murdoch says, this is a very important area for us, and we believe that we can add value by bringing together the data and evidence that already exists and helping to improve that. And as you refer to, we published our sort of data strategy roadmap alongside our statutory reporting in March. We've been working very closely with the Office of National Statistics and equivalent bodies across the nations, and so we've been bringing together the national pictures that do exist. As was referred to, though, we do recognise that the data that we collect, that has been collected so far, isn't collected on an entirely consistent basis, and the Office of National Statistics is trying to bring together the experts to first of all put forward a sort of experimental methodology for having more consistent data between the nations, and then to populate that methodology. So by the end of next year, we hope we'll have better data across the nations. I don't think it won't solve all the issues. I feel sure of that. Partly because we're relying to a large extent on survey data rather than sort of customs data or anything that is mandated. So it's more of a voluntary process. But we are trying to build in a number of different sources to get a more robust picture of trade across the nations, because we do think that's very important.
Did you want to come in, Ms. McQuinnis?
Yes, I was going to say that I completely agree with Rachel. At present, there are significant limitations on the intra-UK data that you pointed out between the nations. The development of the intra-UK trade data is absolutely vital for us. So the strategy roadmap that we've produced sets out the initiative by partners, including the Scottish Government, the ONS, that can improve the collective understanding here. So the purpose of that is to act as a catalyst for the improvement on this evidence base, and it's really building that up. It's going to be very helpful to you and all of us.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Cameron. Did you want to come back in?
The question on export statistics, Scottish export statistics, I wonder if we need to try and achieve more regular publishing of that, if that's feasible. I don't know if that's feasible, but you may have an observation on that or not. I'm not sure.
I mean, I think anything that can be done to improve the data is certainly to be welcomed.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell.
Thanks. I'm wondering to what extent you still have an eye on the European Union, because arguably the European Union is the world's most successful single market, which manages a degree of regulatory divergence between member states within that market. Do you still look across to Europe to see how good practice is developed, how businesses are managing regulatory divergence within their sectors, and what can we learn from that?
Yes, I'm happy to pick that up. I mean, I think there are things that we can possibly learn from a number of different single markets, the European Union clearly being an important one. We also, I think, had a brief look at Australia, Canada, Spain, and a number of different sort of federal organisations, or sort of nations. I think the internal market within the UK does have some specific characteristics, and we started from a position where we were pretty unified, and that does play into the way in which the internal market operates. So certainly it's of relevance, and anything that anybody would like to flag up that we can learn about how that is relevant to the operation of the internal market, we're very open to. So I think it's a good question, and something that we do keep an eye on, but probably no more than an eye, because I think the relevance, we have to be we have to think carefully about the relevance of lessons there for the UK.
Yeah. And when you're working with businesses, I mean, are there particular scales or types of businesses that are more integrated within that European market, who perhaps have got more experience of working within different regulatory setups? I mean, I'm thinking about, because you mentioned in your report about deposit return schemes, and we've got different DRS schemes operating across member states in Europe. I guess some companies will be supplying to only one scheme, some will be working across, you know, the continent, sort of engaging in different models. So I'm interested in you know, what business sectors are particularly adept at working within that larger kind of internal market, and which are perhaps, you know, got concerns around divergence if they're, you know, working to one particular market but not others.
It's a really interesting question, and I suppose that what we've prioritised so far are the sectors in which we've seen the most potential for divergence within the UK, but I think quite often they will also be sectors that have experience of trading, you know, across the EU, that there's no doubt. So I think we flagged up in our report that the environment, food and drink, agriculture, a couple of others are really important areas to us. And certainly, you know, talking about something like the deposit return scheme, we would want to learn, to the extent that we get involved in any work on the deposit return scheme, we'd certainly want to learn lessons about how that operates in other countries.
It is worthwhile thinking about how we would have been used on that basis, and the deposit return scheme, or in fact any other new item of business that that comes up before you consider putting something into legislation, it's worthwhile asking the OIM, this is a sales pitch really, for the their technical advice. I mean, the Peat report that we produced, that's the only report so far that we produced, gives a very good indication of the quality of work from economists from on the legal side as well. So the technical support that's offered there is considerable. So I'd implore people to think about that as a resource, an important resource to look for and provide information to the committee and to the government. The great thing is, at the end of the day, you don't have to take the advice, but it's the technical advice is there to be used. So we're just that's the best way of looking on at the OIM.
Does that advice then get fed into the Common Frameworks process? Is there particular issues that are coming up around single-use plastics or anything else? I mean, would you offer that advice, or have you been asked? Or?
So the people who would come to us asking for advice would be one of the governments. And it's, of course, for them to work out how to use the advice that we offer. But it certainly could be fed through into the Common Frameworks discussions. I mean, it certainly would make sense for that to be the case.
Yes, okay. It applies to all four governments. That's the important part. Just back to the question of transparency. That would be helpful in that sense.
Mm-hmm. I suppose my last question is just about, you know, the value of having divergence in different markets. I mean, is that something that comes through at all in the evidence that you get from businesses? Is it just seen as a barrier, or is it about saying, well, actually, there's maybe a different market for this product in this particular area, we're responding to local needs? You know, is there value in that kind of diversity within markets, or is it just seen as a, well, it's all a bit of a pain having different markets operating in different places?
I think it's really important to recognise that divergence can be both a benefit and, you know, and have some downsides. Clearly, businesses want to be able to trade seamlessly across the UK, and that's some of the issues that we look at. But there are also benefits in terms of innovation, for example, and I think we pulled out a couple of examples of that in our report. You know, the trialling of the charge on carrier bags in Wales. The smoking ban in Scotland. So there are things that I think can usefully be trialled in individual nations as part of a sort of innovative process and then taken on board more widely.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Ms. Forbes.
Thanks very much, and good morning. You, Mr. McLennan, mentioned, and I think response to Neil Bibby, the fact that most businesses don't think of trade barriers when they are trading quite freely. I suppose reflecting on the last few years, there has been a huge amount of upheaval, which may have more commonly than in other times pushed businesses into new markets. So, for example, whether that's rising costs, COVID, or indeed trade barriers associated with Brexit might have encouraged Scottish-based businesses to trade more within the UK, having been trading within the EU, and vice versa. I can think of one business in my constituency that used to trade primarily in the UK that now trades in Europe, and I can think of one that has done the opposite. So in that sense, you've obviously taken a lot of qualitative evidence from businesses. Have you come across that a lot, where businesses are having to adjust to operating within the UK that might have been trading more frequently in Europe and having to deal with some of the challenges that that brings across the UK?
I mean, it's a really interesting question, actually, and I don't think we have had a lot of evidence to that effect, but would be really interested to hear from businesses, you know, who were adjusting to trading within the UK. But I do take your point. I think one thing that we did hear from businesses, or certainly through the research that the independent research that we commissioned as part of our statutory reporting, we heard that businesses were more accustomed now to dealing with regulatory change. Obviously, with the position with the EU, they had increased their sort of agility. I think it would probably be the way that they would have looked at it. And therefore, if they encountered issues within the internal market, they felt that they were better equipped. I think that was certainly true of larger businesses. I think smaller businesses perhaps have more challenges in that respect.
Okay. And my second point was around, again, this notion of raising awareness. You mentioned that the issues on which you received the most submissions are probably the issues that have been most widely in the press. And whether the fear perhaps that's created by some of the press creates more concern amongst businesses that may actually be reflected by the genuine trade barriers that exist.
Are you thinking of anything in particular?
Well, I mean, I suppose your report's obviously considered five areas: glue traps, food and drink, genetic technology, single-use plastics, deposit return scheme, all of which have perhaps been more in the press than other issues.
Yes, well, but you are one of the major stakeholders, so you would bring that to our attention and ask us for advice on that. We don't react to the press, so the unit and the OIM is technical support, and but a very high quality support in that sense, and. If you raised it with us and asked us to investigate it, then we would look at that and take it very seriously.
My question was more about the qualitative evidence that you've taken from businesses in terms of what they've expressed to you.
I see.
You know, do concerns largely get raised on issues that are a focal point in the media, or are they largely because of direct experience that businesses have had?
Well, my experience of business, it's more the effect on the company I would be running than the media. Certainly from my experience, I wouldn't pay too much attention to that.
It does, I suppose, raise awareness in a way that you were suggesting needs to be done in your earlier comment.
Yes, it does, in the sense that when I'm saying we're looking for further assistance on the data collection side, yeah, that's true.
I wonder if I could just ask a supplementary on Ms. Forbes' question with around the issue of businesses that have been agile and pivoted. We're also unfortunately aware of a number of businesses that have ceased trading as a result of this. And I wonder, do you collect data on the number of businesses in particular sectors or the size of the trading in those particular sectors to try to understand if, you know, businesses are just ceasing to trade at all as a result of post-Brexit relations?
I mean, it's a good question, and I think going back to the question of what trade data we can collect at the moment, most of it is at the national level. It's been tricky to get data by sector or by region at the moment, but we're working to get more granular data, and that's part of the kind of roadmap that we've set out.
Okay.
Thank you. Could you bring Mr. Brown, please?
Thanks very much. I'm new to this, I have to say, but just listening to, and also to your point that you started off with a more unified kind of situation, I suppose the implication of which is that we're about to become less unified or experience more diversity or divergence. And it does seem a little bit absurd if you started off in a single market, you're now going to what, even by its name, appears to be a much more insular approach of an internal market. If it's been a single market previously, surely the benefits were there in the first place. And do we need to have bureaucratic superstructures that are regulating or seeking to monitor a situation where we had a single market before? It just seems odd that we'd have to do that.
Fair point. If everyone was trading effectively and there were no issues across the four nations, then yes, there's no need. But as I think you'd understand, there could be some serious divergence going forward into the future. And we're there as again, back to the business of being a technical support, not making decisions on that rest entirely with government.
Just on that, and trying to be helpful here, you mentioned suggestions about meaningful data and so on. One way that you could perhaps build that, whether it's at your own hand or through others, is through an examination of the approved lists of public bodies. So contractors are successfully placed on the approved list of public bodies, information which is probably more easier to gain than elsewhere. And the purpose of that would be, of course, to say that in a perfect market, if innovation and efficiency are rewarded, then you would see huge numbers of Scottish companies servicing Welsh local authorities or English serving Northern Ireland. And that might give you a better indication, especially how it develops over time, as to whether the internal market is working more efficiently. So I wondered if it was possible, either through yourselves, maybe ONS, to get that kind of data and to monitor it over time to see whether it improves or otherwise.
It's worth looking.
Yes, that's really interesting. I'm not aware that we've looked at that to date, but we'll certainly take that away and think about it. Thank you.
Okay, and one last point, and this is counter to the last point we just made, but that's kind of the way that I think of these things. There's also a fairly developed movement of, I forget the term of it, it's not quite a circular economy, but it's seeking, it's a north of England area, maybe Sheffield does this very effectively, where you try and ensure that the money spent by public bodies is spent in the local area, recycled, if you like. And I don't know whether that would be termed as divergence or not, but is that something that you've either come across or you would take into account in these figures? Because there is quite a strong movement across, having moved from CCT decades ago to best value and now to a more liberal regime more recently in the last 10 years, to say, for example, local authorities can place a contract with somebody who's not giving them the cheapest price, but there are wider benefits from placing it with that company. I suppose that kind of works against the idea of an internal market. It's just to see if it's come across your radar yet or not.
No, not really. I mean, our focus is very much on regulatory divergence or alignment rather than in terms of the money spent. So I suppose it's quite that's maybe one answer to that. But no, it's something that we haven't particularly come across so far.
I think that you're right, it probably wouldn't come under divergence, but it certainly would come under the official operation, efficient operation of an internal market.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Stewart?
In the report, you talk about the actions of governments across the nations when it comes to food that may be high in fat, sugar and salt content, and the future divergence that may come from that. Now, that can create and may well create some real difficulties going forward, because for certain businesses and for certain manufacturing or supply bases, they may well have to then deal with different processes across different locations. How do you see that going forward as a possibility, or is it a real issue that is going to become much more apparent as time progresses?
It's a good question, and it is an area that we're interested in sort of looking at more closely. I think we, as you say, there is scope for divergence between the nations about the way in which promotions or labelling or other things take place. So it is something that we're monitoring quite carefully. I don't know, did you want to come in on that?
No. Okay. And from that, I think that, you know, the possibilities of having different locations and different things happening may well become a real issue for the market and for the supplier and also for the consumer, depending on what they wish to take and how they wish to plan that. So it'll be interesting to see what data you may well create from that from the future.
Yes, it's certainly something we may well return to in our next report.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm looking, I don't see any other hands going up. I wonder if I could have a final question. And we've just been discussing ourselves as a committee this morning about the EU tracker and the ambition of the Scottish Government, the Welsh Government, to keep pace with European legislation and the requirement of Northern Ireland to do so anyway. I just wondered if it's something you are considering or something it would be possible to actually look at the trends as to where the Internal Market Act and divergence is happening, if you see a pattern in health or environmental issues or indeed in product development or in the food and drinks industry, and is that something that you would be hoped to be able to report on in the future?
Certainly the idea that we track or we identify trends that are in sectors which are where there's more divergence that's what we're sort of starting to pull out in our statutory reporting already, and we'll get more information on that, I guess, as time develops. So it's certainly something we're interested in. I mean, it's not necessarily divergence from the EU, but that may well then have an impact on the UK internal market. So to that extent, we'll certainly be picking up those trends over time.
Okay. That's fine. Any final questions? Well, Mr. Brown, yep.
Just come back on a point that Donald Cameron raised about the figures which are there for, in that example, Scottish exports. I think you'll find there are huge numbers of very key figures in the economy which really rely on pretty ropey survey data, and that's true across the UK. And I think in Scotland's case, we often have to rely on DfT, or whatever they're now called, and HMRC for some of the figures. But Donald Cameron's point is true that the figures are very woolly, which seems really surprising for a so-called advanced economy in the 21st century. But is it part of your intention to see if you can start to, not just in Scotland, obviously, but across the UK, start to nail down those figures?
Yeah, building market.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's the conversations that we're having with the various sort of expert statistical bodies across the UK to try to get to improve the level of data collection. So, yes, absolutely.
Okay, I think that's exhausted questions from the committee this morning. Can I thank you once again for your attendance at committee? It's been really helpful, and no doubt we'll be seeing you at some point in the future again. And on that note, we go into private session.
Just a small point, that because we continue to engage regularly with a range of stakeholders in Scotland. If the committee have any ideas of other stakeholders that we could talk to? I mean, we've been involved with the Institute of Directors, Food and Drink Federation, Federation of Small Businesses, Law Society, the National Farmers Union. So that engagement's a key part of our work, but you're closer to it. And the Senate very kindly pointed us in the direction of the Royal Welsh Show to engage with their businesses in that fashion. So anything you can think of would be helpful. But just to say again, we are a resource to be used. And it's, I'm not saying you'd be silly not to use it, but it's well worth considering when you're putting things into law. Even after you've done that, and at the end of the day, the committee doesn't have to take the advice of the OIM, but it's there to be used if needed.
That's extremely helpful. I'm sure the committee will put our collective heads together in terms of what this committee might do. But also we have a conveners group for all the subject committees, all the conveners of the Parliament, and it, maybe it'll be that a report to them might be helpful to engage with the subject committees who generally will do much more in-depth analysis of their sectors and what might happen than the Constitution Committee in itself. So we'll take that on board and we'll feedback to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.